Good afternoon. So I look forward to interacting with you all spread over the length and breadth of the country, and wish you all a very happy World Environment Day. What an auspicious day for me to begin, especially since I am interested in talking about economic activity, and we are trying to see how nations can manage themselves by fostering economic development by and at the same time preserving the environment. People call it preservation, conservation, management, and several of this. So in this entire series that during which I am going to have interaction with you, given my background as a of training in economics, I am going to be talking to you about three major dimensions, that is the interplay between economy, environment, and development. So let's start the inquiry from now onwards. Okay, I don't think there will be any dispute among us in terms of why do we need to do this. In fact, right in the inaugural session, my colleague Prof. Sethi and Prof. Patsardi both discussed with you about, you know, how exactly we can look at it and how, why do we need to look at it, etc. But I thought I'll just add two more dimensions to the discussion that we've had at the inaugural. One is, I call them as need of the hour. One is, there's a growing recognition of the need to formulate strategies for sustainable development all over the world. Whether this is especially after the World Earth Summit in 1992 at Rio de Janeiro. So when most countries came prepared with a rudimentary draft and then they started working on it, they said Rio plus 10, Rio plus 20, and now they are planning for Rio plus maybe 30 or 50. And everyone's objective is to see how exactly they can place the economy on the path of sustainable development. What is important is to place the economy on the sustainable development, path of the sustainable development. Once it is placed, then it is supposed to take care. In 1950s, when we embarked on planned development, we Indian economy, we wanted to place the economy on growth path, where we actually called it steady growth path. So we still want the, you know, growth path to be steady, but at the same time sustainable. The word sustainable we perhaps learn much later. The word sustainable was there earlier, but in a very, very different context. It's basically ability for you to sustain the growth, steady growth path. But now they are talking in terms of environmental sustainability. So there is a growing recognition of it. All countries across the world are trying to see how exactly they can place their economy in terms of sustainable growth path. This is true for developed countries, present day OECD countries, as well as the developing countries. OECD, by which I mean the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, or you call it Group 7 or Group 8. The countries are classified in terms of the levels of per capita income. So these are the countries which also need to worry about it, like developing countries. But there is often a debate about whether it is good to be a late starter. Do you have a disadvantage of being a late starter? In fact, when about 13 years back when I was with Cambridge for a brief while, I learnt and met this gentleman, Professor Hajun Chang, who just then published a book titled Kicking Away the Ladder. So then there was a you know, talk by him about the book, so I wanted to go and listen to him. He's a development economist. He said the present day, the developed countries have all laid a ladder and used a ladder to grow, but none of them want the present day developing countries to use the same ladder to climb up. So once they have climbed up, they want to kick away the ladder so that others or followers, the late starters, don't follow that. So he was very critical of the developed countries, which is kicking away this, and he's a co-author with Joseph Stiglitz, who is a Nobel laureate in economics, only declared that year. So I said, can't we really take it as a boon that the ladder is not available to us? Now, much later, people like Professor Partha Dasgupta, a very well known environmental economist, and others argued that developing countries can actually benefit being late starters, especially because they can make proper planning and perspective about ideal mix of the use of resources, preservation of their environment, and achieve economic development. what is the problem that the world is facing today? The developed countries are got the maximum problem, not the developing countries, fortunately, because they have using certain paths of development where they can't cut down on carbon emission, for example, or they are basically spending a lot of money researching about finding out alternate technologies which are environmentally benign, and also they can't really they are finding it very difficult to identify what is the optimal resources exploitation, optimal rate of exploitation of resources. Since developing countries are late starters, they can plan for it right from beginning, and therefore it can be taken as a advantage, and they can really talk about it. But of course, it is not without constraints. So developed countries are willing to share. So it's not that for benevolent they want to give this money for carbon trading and others. It's because they are unable to cut, and since the GHG gas emissions are really mounting, so they want developing countries to practice all this, so that, and they are willing to transfer resources or share the cost of it with the developing countries. So that's exactly where it comes from, because they are unable to cut down. But the moment you start looking at formulating a strategy for development, especially sustainable development, what happens here is you must understand that there is an interrelationship between economic activity and the environment. Now, this economic activity, therefore, we have to also start, before I thought I will definitely start the discussion with you, first with what exactly is the interrelationship between economy and the environment. Can the economic development take place without harming the environment? Or is it necessary and sufficient condition, that is necessary and sufficient to exploit the natural resources and destroy the environment in order to be growing on high growth path, proceeding on high growth path to achieve economic development? Is that really required? We will inquire into that. There is no certain answer. We will definitely see what are the pathways available. But today, we are also at the crossroads where it's 20 years since the beginning of WTO, World Trade Organization. 163 countries in the world have signed WTO. Everyone, they thought China will not be asked to sign, China has also signed. Where the rules of the game, what does WTO say? In a nutshell, rules of the game for trade related activities are governed by WTO. So if your economy is open, in the sense that open to exports and imports, as well as for investment capital flows, into as well as outflow, then you need to definitely take into account, you have to strictly follow the rules of the game, and these rules are prescribed by WTO. Now, around again, most economies, when they want to open up, have also embarked upon since 1991 around the world the path of globalization. Globalization is a process whereby you are trying to link your economy with the economies of the rest of the world. Now, that means there is interdependence between your economy and economies of the rest of the world. So, if there is a financial crisis in US economy, it will affect all the trading economy, all the trading partners. But it may be good, it may also have some adverse impact. So, you have to be prepared once you link. There are several advantages, that is why most economies have really got into the path of, embarked on the globalization path. So, with WTO and globalization ruling in the last 2 decades and more, the environmental concerns have also got reshaped. Very small example I will give you is, most of the exporters, if you ask them, they say we require green labeling. Apart from others, like you have to certify that they don't violate human rights and others, but green labeling has become a very important factor. Are developing countries becoming dumping ground for the environmentally hazardous goods? Are they also becoming heavens for investment in those industries, the creation of most of the manufacturing industries, which they are not able to do in continue in their own country because of strict environmental regulations? So when our Prime Minister Modi said Make in India campaign, he started Make in India, several people worried that should we make the environmental standards stricter, comparable to what is there in Europe and US, so that this does not attract the most polluting industries to India. So therefore, one needs to be cautious about this. So that is why it is important to understand the differences in the concern that have emerged with WTO and globalization. Third important, you know, aspect that I want to talk about, again interrelationship, is management of natural resources. We talked about management of resources, mostly financial resources and capital resources, etc. earlier. But today, most countries in the world are talking about natural resources, because they are, it's, Japan is an exception, which have grown at high rate without having the endowment of natural resources, much of natural resources. Whereas most other countries which have been able to grow, barring the sub-Saharan Africa, which are endowed with a lot of natural resources, but still not able to grow, because they are all by and large exporting staple resources to other countries. So, in the process of management of natural resources, there are two important aspects that have come into play. One is the institutions. My colleague Dr. Parthasarathy will also be talking about some of the institutions, especially in the context of management of common pooled resources. But the kind of institutions that are required today are very different from what one had in 1950s, 60s and 70s, etc. And these institutions have really come up, they have come to play a very important role in India as well as elsewhere. And also the enforcements, separate kind of enforcements, separate institutions which are basically to enforce the laws of the land with respect to environment have also come into being in the last few decades. So, these aspects also need to be definitely understood. So, it is not simply economic activity, but reshaping of the economic activity in the last two to three decades that has taken shape in the form of this is what I intend to also talk to you about. Because what I am talking to you today is only, just giving a prelude, the first part, prelude to what is in store. So, then what is the objective? So, in terms of the perspective, following the norms given by the UGC and others. So, basically idea here is to stimulate the students to think that, basically the course aims to provide an overview of the issues involved. It is important, is enough if we can stimulate or motivate the students to think that what are the issues that are involved in planning, policy formulation as well as implementation for effective conservation and management of the environment. That is what is definitely required. But again, when you talk about conservation of the environment, it is not at the cost of low growth rate, because without economic growth, there cannot be human prosperity, and you cannot sacrifice on human welfare, because then you will be declared as a sadist. So, that is definitely not what we want. So, it is possible. So, what we are also trying to say, is it possible to combine high growth path with environmental management is something that we are going to sort of discuss and learn together. And the issues that we are going to talk about are both theoretical as well as practical, especially that arises from formulating strategic planning for sustainable development, again both at the micro as well as at the macro level. Because what is the level at which one should plan? Let me give an example. In India in 1950s, you all would have heard about what is called centralized planning, where Yojana Bhavan, people sitting in Yojana Bhavan in New Delhi used to plan for the entire country, top down approach. Much later, people embarked upon decentralized planning. Again, there was a debate what level of decentralization. So, people said we should go for Panchayati Raj. So, Panchayat level planning aggregated to block, district, state and then nation. Is that what is objective? So, what I have said, we have tried both in the last 65 years plus. Planning started in 1950, so 65 years. But still, we have problems of poverty, we have problems of inequality, we have problems of haphazard development across states and poor urbanization, poor urban planning, etc. So, there are a number of issues that come both at the micro as well as macro level. Since the course is not a pure course on development economics, we are focusing more on the interplay between economy and the environment. So, in that context, we try to see how we can deal with it at the micro as well as the macro level. I must say that even this part that I am going to talk to you about, that is why we have all sandwiched them together, is interdisciplinary, highly interdisciplinary. It is not simply I am going to give you economic theory and economic tools to look at this. The course is highly interdisciplinary with special emphasis on environmental economics here and socio-economic perspective in planning and implementation for environmental conservation and pollution management in these modules that I am going to be talking to you about. But the course is definitely, as you have already noticed, would have been is highly interdisciplinary. So, what exactly we are going to deal with are basically concepts and issues related to economy, environment, linkages, the concept and measurement of green GDP. Yesterday there was a discussion in Delhi about the new measures of GDP, but we are going to talk about green GDP, which is also now CSO has undertaken, Central Strategic Organization has undertaken steps for this. Then what are the various economic instruments that can be used for pollution control, and if there is time, we will also talk about designing a policy for industrial pollution control, which some of you may confront, especially since you are teaching several of the engineering courses. Let me see how exactly we can deal with it. Okay. In addition, if there is time, because today everyone talks about climate change, the monsoon is yet to set in. We are all hoping that it will start from 1st June. Now this is 3rd June, today is 5th June, there is no sign of monsoon. I do not know, my friends in Kerala can say whether they have started, monsoon has started. It has been raining there in May, but people say it is pre-monsoon showers. So there is climate change. So what are the economic impacts of climate change? Some part of it we will discuss in this program if there is time, because when they made this syllabus, UGC may not really talk about climate change. So that is why I am putting it as an additional factor. And of course, in the entire interaction, I would like you to get familiarized with, and that is what we intend our students also to get familiarized with, not necessarily to by heart, mug up, or become champions of this, but just get familiarized with tools and techniques of analysis. There are concepts like transaction costs, cost benefit analysis, contingent valuation, environmental impact assessment, social impact assessment, etc. Some gist of it we will try to understand as we proceed. I do not want to keep one lecture only for the concept, because it get boring, and also is very difficult. It is a big challenge for me to keep you awake, especially after your lunch break and towards fagam end of the day today. Okay. But I must say, since a number of you would be keen on knowing what is environmental economics all about. Economics itself, I do not use any of the definitions given by so many textbooks, because one of my teachers told me 30 years ago that economics is nothing but common sense in the complicated form. So then we were wondering, you mean to say that every common sense economics is not at all, but you can deconstruct all economic concepts and theories, and finally when you deconstruct, people say, oh, this is something that I already knew, isn't this common sense? So it is common sense in a complicated form, and environmental economics is no exception. Okay. But there are two dimensions, from micro as well as from the macro perspective, where in the microeconomic perspective largely deals with the behavior of an individual or a firm, a business or a particular market. Whereas macro, we are dealing with aggregates. Economy as a whole is what we are talking about. But at the micro level also, we are talking about policies. Policies to control, especially market failure. I should tell you what is market failure in a while. And alternatively, there are also people in the macro level, we keep hearing in newspaper, Raghuram Rajan talks about monetary policy, Arun Jaitley talks about fiscal policy. And trade policy, of course, I guess Nirmala Sitharaman will be talking about trade policy today. I am talking about current ministers who are in charge of this activity. So at the country level, we talk about monetary, fiscal and trade policy, which have widespread effect on various dimensions. Okay. But some of the issues that we get involved in microeconomics are the following. Each one of it is a major discipline research area. For example, to start with, we are looking at the theory of public goods. Now the question is, what is public good? What are public goods? This bottle of water that they have given me to drink if I am thirsty is a private good, because I am not going to share it with anybody else here. Private good, given only to me. But the air that we breathe, public good. So What makes the, how do you distinguish? Are you going to talk about each of the commodity and discuss? No. So public goods by definition have two characteristics. Any commodity where there is no rivalryness in consumption. non-rivalry nuts. Means you can consume it when I am also consuming it simultaneously. Street light is an example. All the people walking in the street can benefit from the street light. So I am talking to you now, I am talking to you, there are 450 plus centers now, I don't know how many around that. And then you can't exclude others from listening to me. So this is also becoming more of a public good, and if it is put in public domain, it is an example of public good. Second characteristic is non-excludability. Non-rivalness, you can consume together. But if you, the fact that you can't exclude someone else, non-excludability. So usually we give the example of street lamp. So there was a survey. Kenneth Arrow, a Nobel laureate in economics long back, said he came up with a theorem called Arrow's impossibility theorem. He said there that in the case of private good, how much of this should be supplied in the market, the water bottles. So they take individual preferences and then sum it horizontally and then to come up with the market demand for water, number of water bottles. But the same way you can't arrive at for public goods, because public goods are usually provided in large quantities. It's very difficult to submit individual, because individual preferences can vary. Somebody will say, I prefer to have a park here. Someone will say, no, we must have a lake here. Third person will say, no, we should have, it's a playground for children. So you start taking people's preferences and trying to aggregate, then you know you can't take preferences. So before Arrow called it as impossible to submit. So it's called Arrow's impossibility theorem. But what's important here is, when you rank, then somebody has to provide this public good. So we give, let's start with the example of a street lamp. So there was a survey done. There was no street lamp in a particular colony. So there was a survey done. Residents of the area came together. Society forms, and then society starts asking people, would you like to support installing a street lamp in our streets? So they know that if you say yes, you will have to necessarily pay, share the cost of installing the street lamp. So people, what they tend to do is, now I can always say no, because majority will say yes and they will install, and if, since I have said no, they will not ask me for money. Obviously, if majority says no, then you can't have the street lamp. So they expect majority of the people to be rational and say yes, therefore some people decide not to say yes. So if you turn around and say, is it possible for the residents to identify those households which have said no to street lamp, and then say, and keep a watchman, and then say that any member of the family walks on these streets after the street lamp is switched on should be asked to close their eyes and walk. It's humanly impossible to monitor that. So this problem in economics is what we call it, the problem of free ridership. So public good entails by definition what is called free ridership. So there will always be free rider, and because there are free riders, the market will never come up with provision of this, supply of this. Therefore you need government to supply public goods. That is why most of the public works program are undertaken by the government, not by the private investors. It is only now that they are saying we will install, provided the government says you can have tolls and then collect tolls, which has also been abolished in Maharashtra recently. So there may not be any incentive for them to come forward. How will they recover? And thirdly, public goods involves a lot of investments. Why I am talking about the public good is because environment is a global public good. Initially they asked, is it a public good for India, is it for Maharashtra, is it for Tamil Nadu or for Jammu and Kashmir? What is public good there? Or is a global public good? The GHG gas emission, ozone layers are global public goods. When you talk about climate change, it's a global public good. So the theory of public good has to be rewritten now in the context of talking about environment. Secondly, the concept of externality. Externality by definition means that any in your action, in production or consumption, there could be somebody who is adversely affected or positively affected. So we call it negative externality or positive externality. Chemical plant near a housing colony, releases waste to the water body nearby, negative externality. But it provides employment opportunity for people in the colony, positive externality. We have to deal with both. When there is positive externality, for example, if there is a music company which plays music, most of the time all the residents in that area enjoy free music. The company cannot enforce and tell all the residents, since you are all quietly listening to music that I am playing, everybody should pay. It's impossible to price it and sell it. There could also be cases, so there, and again, negative, both negative is difficult to, negative externality is difficult to enforce, I mean regulate, and positive externality is also very difficult, therefore the market will fail. Because in these cases, consumption and production, externalities are inbuilt, positive as well as negative. So if there are inbuilt, market will fail. So to correct market failure, government intervention is definitely required. That's exactly where we get into externalities and market failure. So this is more prevalent in the case of environmental goods, environmental services, etc. Therefore, we'll talk about externalities and market failure in specific cases. Thirdly, there's a very interesting development that has taken place in the tools of analysis called cost benefit analysis, which is done by government for most of the investment projects, even earlier. Now they do cost benefit analysis of what are the costs and benefits attached, even if they want to start a new engineering college. Cost benefit analysis is basically done. Or they want to construct a new dam, check dam or something else, the bridge, cost benefit analysis is basically done. What are the costs and benefits? So now the cost benefit analysis is a very important tool that has also been used widely in the case of environmental goods and services. Fourthly, we have to come up with environmental policy, center, state, coastal zone regulation, several others are part of the environmental policy. And finally, there are also environmental audit system that has come. So professional auditing is being done in number of cases. So all this encompasses what is called microeconomic issues in terms of from the environmental point of view, which are basically started from the economic point of view, but then switched over to, I mean, which are very important concerns for from environmental perspective. Some of the macroeconomic concerns I've already mentioned to you, like economic growth and environment, WTO, etc. But management of natural resources, institutional enforcement is also something I mentioned to you. Now, coming to the last three aspects here, valuation of environmental resources, that has all become very important. But we have gone so crazy that China showed the way to the rest of the world. They said, we want to impute value to the monkeys in China, rare species. So we want to impute value. We say, because when you talk about value, we don't value ourselves. We don't say 1 billion population means every individual is worth, say, 1 crore. Therefore, our value GDP includes the value of human resources. So it is 1.2. That is the potential GDP of India. We don't say that. But when it comes to forests or oil, gas resources, etc., we do valuation of environmental resources. Now, people have also started, like China, Sudan, in terms of some of the species. So they gone to the extent of valuing means economic valuation of monkeys. So government thought, should we start doing it in India? They attempted only one, valuation of Royal Bengal tiger. After that, they stopped, thankfully. It's impossible to value. So that's not what we are talking about here. We are talking about valuation of environmental resources, which the environment gives us, which we can use, but at an optimal rate so that it can be available for us as well as for the future generation. Therefore, valuation, why is valuation required? Valuation is required because unless you tell the people how valuable it is, people will not take it seriously. Of course, there is in economics, we have the paradox of value. I always tell all the students right in the first class, paradox of value is water is something that you cannot live without. Water is something that you cannot live without. But how much are you ready to pay? 20 or 30 rupees per month. Diamond is something that you can live without. How much are you ready to pay? 30 or 40,000 rupees. This is what we call paradox of value. Water is scarce, so is diamond. So it's not simply scarcity definition, but it's because the what we call it paradox of value. Now, but this valuation of enumerable resources is important, because then only you will attach, once you attach value, then you will respect it. You may remember in our grandparental generation, in villages, etc., they used to say, when the taps were installed first, earlier we used to draw water from well, then we attached motor, installed taps in all the bathrooms and washrooms and others. Water started flowing. Then we started using, buckets and others to fill up water. And very often I tell the students, because they all stay in the hostel, they open the tap, water doesn't come, they just walk away. And whenever water comes, it flows through all unless someone sees. Everybody will be in the academic area, water will go down the drain. I've noticed it when I was a student staying in the hostel, and used to go tell them, please close the tap if it doesn't come, or after use, so that the water is preserved. And we know how important, valuable water is. So what used to be taught to us when we were children is, if you allow the water to go down the drain, your wealth will also go down the drain. So you are trying to attach, you are trying to, draw a parallel between the water and wealth. Now today, there are water engineers, there are water entrepreneurs, all the tankers that supply water to a number of places, and water entrepreneurs. Water trade is a very important dimension. So some valuation of enumerable resources is basically done. So when they charge you for water, depending upon the demand supply mismatch, basically intersection of demand and supply. That's why the water rates differ across, especially for privately available water resources. So the valuation of enumerable resources becomes extremely important. And another important dimension that has come now is in terms of maintaining biodiversity or ecological balance. So energy ecology linkage and modeling is also very, very popular. People are using high-end models, programming, including MATLABs, to solve some of these models. And finally, environmental and natural resource accounting has also become extremely important, that they started doing it. It was about 15 years ago when we started doing it for India. Before that, some researchers started doing it for China, and then it was dismantled. In 1992, they said SCES started, System of Environmental and Economic Accounting, where you talk about economic accounting and also bring in environmental accounting. And then you redefine your GDP based on the amount of environmental resources consumed. When you do that, we find that the green GDP value goes much lower than the GDP levels. And if you impute value to environmental resources, some studies have shown states in India which are very low in terms of per capita income are scoring very high. Of course, the critics will ask you, is it all right to preserve the environment, but no need for improving the per capita income in those regions? Not at all. One should not embark on that at all. So therefore, there are a lot of trade-offs that we face, so we see how much we can sort of talk about it. So having given this introduction, I want you to think it over now. This is only an introduction, prelude to what is in store in this 5 sessions that I'm going to be interacting with you. Just an introduction to what is going to be discussed. So I start by looking at the first topic, which deals with interaction between economic activities and environment. Now I'm not talking about development, I'm only saying economic activities. I suppose we can proceed. So basically, interaction between economic activities and environment. Now, very simple diagram that I put this together. In all economies, whether you talk about US, UK, Europe, Japan, China, India, the economic activities can be broadly classified into 2, consumption and production. Consumption cannot take place with production. Production without consumption is meaningless. Somebody has to consume, otherwise they have to throw it in ocean. Whom are they producing it for? We are talking about consumption and production of all goods and services in an economy. We are talking about an economy, within an economy. We talk about Indian economy or Chinese economy or the world economy. One economy, one country's economy. So all the economies have economic activity can be classified into production and consumption. How does the production take place? Of course, households and people live. People live in all the economies, all the countries. Who become the consumers? So, these consumers are endowed with, we are only talking about two sector model. We are not talking about trade, we are not talking about government, we are not talking about tax authorities, nothing. Simply, we are starting a simple model. After that, we will complicate. So, every economy has two important players, two important actions. One is production, other one is consumption. So, the consumption is carried out by households, individuals and families. So, these people, in order to consume, have to purchase goods and services. Or they have to grow, including they have to, you know, farmers growing in their own farm, etc. But when they do that, they become producers, production activity. So, in order to produce, the consumers or households are endowed with what is called factors of production. So, we have four factors of production in economics called land, it's for cultivation and others. Without land, you can't have institutions or industries. Labor, effort that is being put into by human beings. Now, including robots come in now. Robots don't consume, they only consume electricity, perhaps. Land, labor. Third one is capital, where we talk about capital in term, mostly in terms of investments, financial capital and others, including natural capital now, one is talking about. And fourth one is management or entrepreneurship, those who run the businesses. So, they are also households, they are also individuals and they consume. So, four factors of production that is supplied by and large by households are called land, labor, capital and organization. They are factors of production. Whom do they supply this to? They supply this to the production process or what is called the manufacturers. The producers use these factors of production to produce and supply to the market goods and services for the consumers. By and large, they supply it for the production to the market for the benefit of consumers. So, if the, all of them are consumed, then the circle is complete, but it is very difficult to have barter exchange. Therefore, we monetized. The problem of barter is where goods are exchanged for goods, that I work for 8 hours a day in a factory or teach in IIT and then I am paid in the form of 10 kilograms of rice or 5 kilograms of wheat, which is very difficult barter system. Because what happens is, suppose I am not a wheat consumer, I am a rice consumer. I take it to him and then say, can you exchange this rice, wheat for rice? He may say, knowing that I know I am desperate for rice, he will say, you have to give me 2 kilograms of wheat for 1 kilo of rice that I give it to you. An unequal exchange. So, in barter, sometimes he may not be wanting this wheat at all, therefore he will say, I don't want wheat. So, first of all, barter to work, you need to have coincidence of wants. Two people should have liking for each other's, whatever each other has. Therefore, barter system failed. So, we need to monetize, where we valued everything in terms of medium of in terms of money, whatever currency that is, rupee, yen, dollar, whatever, or euro. So, we monetize and then say we get in compensated in terms of money and then we use the money to buy goods and services. So, the factors of production earn in return for whatever the consumers are supplying to the production process. Land earns rent, labor earns wages and salaries apart from other perks and others, capital earns interest, profits are given to entrepreneurs. So, four factors of production, land, labor, capital, organization earn rent, wages and salaries, interest and profits that come back to the consumers. Now, this is what they spend to buy and use the service, goods and services done in the production process. So, the circle is complete. That is what we start economic activity for any country. Theoretically, this is how we try to present it, a simple two sector model. Now see how I bring in environment here in terms of consumption as well as production. But you can see there are two arrows which show R1 and R2. Very easy to explain R1. Farmers retain a portion of the crop as seeds for next crop, which is not sold in the market. So resource they retain for themselves for reinvestment, seed purposes or other purposes, etc. So that is R1. It doesn't go to the market system, it retained within themselves. Again, consumers buy number of goods and services, they consume, but they also retain a lot of it for future. So R2, they also recycle. That is, activity takes place within the consumption activity. So R1 and R2 are activity which goes on within consumption, production, etc. So fair enough, in a simple circular flow. But as this consumption production, which has been going on since ages, several, you know, centuries, and with modernization, what happens? The consumption as well as production releases a lot of waste. Today we talk about e-waste, solid waste, liquid waste, and several of this, environmentally benign, environmentally non-benign, damaging, several of this form, both the consumption as well as production process. So they are biological process. So this is all put to what is called waste sink, which is also there in the country. There are dumping grounds all over the country where we sort of use it as a waste sink. Sometimes wetlands are used for waste sink, sometimes several other places in cities, urban areas, in the suburbs, outskirts, there are lands main where we go and dump the waste. Now, the system is also, waste management is changing now. Waste management become an important discipline and highly difficult right now, because as the consumption increases, waste also increase. As the population increases, consumption increases, waste also increase. So it is much more challenging to have waste management. As the population increases, demand for commodities and services increases, production also goes up, again waste increases. I am not talking about once the production goods goes to consumers and then waste is released, it comes to waste sink directly. From consumption to waste sink, that is E2. But production to waste sink also takes place. Again, coming to production to E2, that also takes place. Release of hazardous waste, non-hazardous waste, air pollution, water pollution and others. And several others, even raw material waste and several the production process, all the waste that is generated in the production process. All that comes to what is called the waste sink. Now, waste management has become so important that I would like to share with you my personal experience that I had when I lived in Tokyo for a year, about 15 years ago. That's when I learned how important waste management is becoming. Where? Suppose you use a, when you go as a new family to live in a city like this, there are a lot of fellow Indians who approach you, and then they start approaching you and they said, no, don't buy a television, don't buy a refrigerator, etc., we'll give you. So many households I got introduced to. So I was wondering how our fellow countrymen have become so generous when they move out of the country. Now, I was really surprised. I said, why is everybody? I hardly know them. It's only later as I was talking to them, I realized that they have to pay a heavy price. So then I asked, what about, suppose I'm leaving, I'm here only for a year, after that what do I do? He said, look for someone like you who will enter next year and pass it on to that guy and then go. I said, but why are you so generous? Why are you giving me all this? Because I got off excellent offers for various electronic goods from these guys. Because they all want to replace it, there is no space in their houses, they want to buy state-of-the-art machines now, but they don't know what to deal with the old ones, there is no space. And if you have to return, you can't put it in the municipal dustbin. If you leave it without telling the government, then there is a huge penalty. And every commodity is recorded in the name of the purchaser. No way you can cheat. It's followed in Japan even today. So if you are to legally dispose, how do people dispose of? Then you write to the municipal corporation saying that, look, I have this old television which I don't want to use it anymore. So I'll pay you whatever. Please tell me how much I pay. And the price that they pay is 30% of the market price of the commodity in most cases. So they said you can experiment. So I was taken to a departmental store. I went there. I asked them what is the price of a television, color television. So they said you just want to buy a new one or you want to exchange. I said I have nothing to exchange. I just want to buy a new one. If you want to buy a new one, 7,000 yen. I said, what if I had to exchange? 10,000 yen. I will pay more. In India, it's the other way around. If you give old one and want to exchange it for a new one, they give you a discount. So, typical Indian case, I argued. They said, no, no. Because we have to take care of the waste disposal. Because the price they had to pay to the, you have to pay to the government for disposal of that is so high. So that is why they tend to, so waste management becomes extremely important in all these countries. Soon it's coming in our country as well. Because where do they dump? It's a big issue. But as the production process increases, growth process of the economy, consumption also increases, waste sink will also. So there's more and more pressure on the waste sink. Coming back to this. With modernization of production as well as consumption, we are also heavily dependent on the energy as well as materials. Energy and materials were basically needed only for production process earlier, but now we need it for production consumption also. We need gas for the stove or oil. We also need microwave oven, electricity for running a microwave oven, OTG or others. Washing machines require electricity. So, energy and materials are required for consumption as well. So, production and consumption both require energy and consumption. As production and consumption expands, the demand for energy and material also increases. So, you need to produce more of energy, more of materials. Fine, that's also part of the, otherwise you can't keep pace with the production. So, I'll tell you later on, but I'll just give an example here. If you look at the GDP of Indian economy, they have growth targets, 5%, 7%, 8% per annum growth rate of GDP. But to produce the GDP, you require a lot of energy, especially electricity. Now, if you look at the demand-supply mismatch in electricity or energy in general, that gap is not narrowing. So, in spite of not meeting the target for energy consumption, energy requirement, you still are able to grow at this rate, it's commendable. That means you are perhaps are becoming more efficient in producing. Coming back here, therefore, the demand for energy and material increases as production and consumption expand. So, two circles I put them together. So, that union is something we need to worry about. But as these two activities improve, what it takes away is the third circle called E3, which is what is called amenities, which are by and large meant for consumer households, for consumption activity. You need parks, natural parks, lakes and several others. As the demand for wasting increases, as the demand for energy and material increases, this becomes, because it's also important you know, as E2 increases, as E1 increases, E2 also will increase, because the lot of waste that is coming out of energy and material production also, fly ash from the thermal power plants. So that will also go into the waste sink. Several other waste that is released from the energy production goes into waste sink. So therefore, there is a pressure on E2 to expand further and further. As production and consumption expands, demand for E1 increases And finally, they all put pressure on E3, which is amenity available. So, when that becomes unsustainable, threatening, then we wake up and then say, oh no, it's every time we worry about it. Otherwise, it results in climate change. So, finally, therefore, you are taken to the arrow outside the system, what is called E4, which is global life support system, where we talk about GHG emissions, ozone layer, and the like. From simple economic activity of these two sectors, we are trying to link it to economic activity. So, what are we trying to do? In a nutshell, what we are trying to discuss here are, we take two sectors, economic activity classified into two sectors, consumption and production. Consumption are handled by households and production are handled by businesses. There is exchange of goods, services and factors of production between these two sectors. Goes from one to the other and again the other to one. Come back here. So, environment here is shown in two important ways. In terms of E1, E2 and E3, all the three interlinked circles. That is how we are trying to put environment, present environment, and trying to link it to consumption and production activity. We are also trying to put it in terms of all encompassing boundary label E4. So, these are the two ways. So, because E4 affects not only you, but also other countries in the world, we call it global life support system. But E1, E2 and E3 are by and large internal to the country because of your, that does not mean there is a problem of E1 and E2, E3 does not necessarily mean that we cut down on consumption and production, then there is no progress in their economy. As economic progress takes place, consumption, demand for consumption will increase, demand for production will also increase, therefore, so both the activities have to go on, no way you can stop. In fact, if you look at the entire climate change debate, they talk about business as usual. But we cannot talk about business, we are talking about growing rate. India and China are rated as the fastest growing economies in the last 10 years. When all others are struggling to grow at 2 to 3%, we are growing at 8 to 9%. Growth rate I am talking about, or 7 to 9%, in that range, fluctuates. That growth has to be, and other countries also will have to keep on growing to reach at the consumption level of the first world countries or the developed countries. That means how much of pressure on E1, E2 and E3. How are we going to manage this? When production consumption expands and E1, E2, E3, and if the pressure on this also increases. So, let me give you a simple anatomy here. Production sector extracts energy resources, for example, like oil. This is a typology, how exactly this takes place. As well as mineral resources like iron ore from the environment, they use this for manufacturing process. Now, this production process are basically these inputs now, you use in the production process, are transformed into two kinds of output. We always talk about good output, useful output, but we also will have to talk about bad output, which is waste, for example, SO2. So, there is some recycling of resources within the production sector shown by R1 and within the consumption sector say R2, that takes place, but we still have to deal with the bad output or waste. So, when you are dealing with this, we start questioning what is the role of environment. So, when you are introducing this to students, I would say, please talk in terms of economic activity and then try to bring in the role of environment. Then only they will get interested. Because there's, one need not talk about environment without the economic activity, or economic activity will have to definitely go on, which everyone will definitely appreciate. So, environment here plays a very important role. Firstly, as supplier of resources, which already all of you know in terms of natural resources as well as various, I mean in terms of timber or oil, gas, water, what not, other materials, iron ore, etc., zinc and what not, copper. Secondly, environment also, so it means it provides the resources for your investment, production process, etc. So it's a supply of resources. Environment also plays a very important role in terms of providing, acting like a sink or receptor, as the term it is, for waste products. There was no problem in many of the villages for a long time, because most of the waste were that we generated and the practice that we had were biologically processed. But today the wastes are processed both biologically as well as chemically by the environment. Chemical process also takes place, it's fine when it comes to, when it becomes manure for further production, cultivation, etc. We are not saying all the waste that go into the environment are damaging or harmful. Whether they can turn out to be harmful depends on the number of factors. A few examples is what I am giving: volume of waste, total quantity, because we have to talk about carrying capacity, temperature at which the waste is being dumped into, rate of replacements, timber, water is basically in terms of water as well as the, why are the water table declining? Because the extraction of, rate of extraction of water is much higher than the rate at which it can get replaced. Same with respect to forests also, leads to deforestation. So cutting of tree is common, but what is the rate at which you have to cut the trees, especially in an estuary, for example. So whether harmful or not, this waste being dumped into the environment depends on volume, temperature, as well as the rate of replacement. For example, I am only giving few others, number of others you can list. This also becomes a problem because there is a limited assimilative capacity. So we start studying, is there a limit for assimilative capacity? Or in other words, we start worrying about what is called threshold effect. Are there some threshold effect? Are there some thresholds beyond which we should not disturb this environment for as a sink? We should move on, move to elsewhere. In terms of water bodies, in terms of your wetlands and several of this. So environment plays a very important role in terms of supply of resources as well as in terms of acting as a sink or receptor for the waste products. Now, not all wastes are bad, but whether it is harmful or not depends on number of factors. If there are threshold effect, then we need to worry about. That is why concentration of people in one locality, one particular place where the density is very high, can actually be dangerous. What happens to the environment when you dump all this, when you try to use it as sink? So there are what is called natural processes that most of us are aware. For some inputs to the environment, there are no natural processes to transform them into harmless or less harmful substances. Then when we are inputting, when you are dumping something on the environment, it becomes input for the environment. There are no natural processes to transform. Some example is what I am trying to present here. Cumulative and conservative pollutants like metals such as lead, cadmium, man-made substances like PCBs and DDT. How does the environment deal with this? And also we talk about bioaccumulation. So they may not be simple processes for them to make it less harmful. Some of them can be transformed to less harmful, but some can be very, very harmful for the environment and therefore for us also, for the living beings. So that's why it's important that we deal with that. Another important aspect when you talk about environment is, environment also acts as a supplier of amenity, the third dimension, E3. It provides educational and spiritual value to society. A lot of people go a number of places for meditation. or to say, for example, people in Europe may derive pleasures from existence of wilderness areas in the northern Canada or in tropical moist forests, rainforests, the Himalayas. We would definitely not like that to be destroyed. So, environment really acts as a major supply of amenity, educational as well as spiritual values to society. So, it is important that we, how valuable it is. So, we start looking into theory of environmental valuation. It is very difficult to input value to the resources available in Himalayas. But some valuation is required in order to make sure that people start respecting it. Without valuation, we may not respect. We value in mostly in terms of the economic value. We may, I am not saying we all will. So, therefore, valuation becomes essential in order to drive across the point. And another important dimension that comes here is, having said all this, economics always deals with trade-offs because of scarcity. But in the process, we learn to identify and discuss and then resolve conflicts. I am not talking about political conflicts here, I am not talking about other kinds of conflicts here, but conflicts in resource use. Using a mountain region as a source of minerals could mean its amenity value is reduced. Whose opinion is more important? For whom should we give greater weightage? For those who use it as amenity or for those who want to use it as mineral, source of mineral? There is no answer, not easy. Using a river as a waste disposal unit means its amenity value is reduced and that we can no longer extract so many material resources, for example, fish to eat from it. How do we deal with this? So, again there is a conflict. Should we allow the water to remain clean so that fish can grow and the fish production can continue to expand, or we should also now start using it as a sink for waste disposal. Felling a forest for its timber resources, the electricity generating capacity of a dam owing to soil erosion and reduce amenity value since the forest inhabitants like animal and humans are displaced or destroyed. So, we need to deal with that aspect as well. And finally, final example, preserving a wetland for its aesthetic value foregoes the use of drained land for agriculture. So, there is a conflict. Of course, now you should add, we do not want preservation of wetland, there is a conflict between those who want to have housing in urban areas and preservation of wetlands. We have intruded into several of the wetlands, two of most cities. We have done a couple of studies, research on the wetlands in India, in coal wetlands in Kerala as well as in the East Calcutta wetlands, etc. We will find that aesthetic quality, there is a trade-off between these. How do we deal with this? It is very difficult to find answer to all this. So, but it is important that we understand this, that the conflicts exist and see how we can circumvent the conflict, how we can avoid, what is the best way to which. We can't completely eradicate the conflict. Conflict will remain. But how to act when there is a conflict, how to plan and use it optimally when there is a conflict. Now, coming to that E1, we talked about E2, now we are coming to E1, E2 and E3. Now, coming to E1, I am posing this example. Is it necessary that energy use has to increase for the output of an economy to grow? In other words, does rising output means rising energy use? Compared across countries, now doing research on India also in this. What we find here is, as economic growth occurs, energy and material demands per real value of output have tended to fall. That is the 1 rupee worth of GDP. What is the required for every rupee worth of GDP, what is the energy consumed? That has started declining. Not only here, it started declining elsewhere first, France, Germany, Japan and UK, where energy consumption per dollar, per euro of GDP produced in those countries have started declining. So as you grow, you tend to become, because of technological progress, you tend to learn and become more productive in use of energy, and therefore your output expands, but energy consumption does not expand in the same proportion, and therefore when the numerator increases, denominator also increases, but not in the same proportion, the ratio increases. Means you tend to become more efficient in the use of energy. So rising output does not necessarily mean rising energy use, at least in terms of per value, per dollar, per rupee or per euro of the value of output produced. And we find, researchers have shown, that most of the reductions in the energy by real GDP ratios in these countries is accounted for by changes in the composition of energy use. When you say technological progress, also in terms of change of composition of energy use, away from coal and towards petroleum and nuclear sources. What about their environmental impacts? Of course, we will have to deal with that. All of them have, coal have, fossil fuel, petroleum also has, nuclear also has, health apart from energy, environmental hazards. We will have definitely look into it. But what I am trying to say here is one simple point, that rising output development need not necessarily mean that you have to have only expansion of energy consumption. You can also become efficient in using it. So that is where I try to present E1, E2 and E3. I try to bring in E4 now, which largely is global life support services. Maintenance of atmospheric composition suitable for life. That's what is important from the global life support services point of view. Maintenance of temperature and climate, and recycling of water and nutrients. They're all essential implications for the world as a whole. So therefore, E4 is important. That is why countries are coming together to negotiate Kyoto Protocol, conference on climate change, discussion on climate change, COPs that keeps taking place. Several rounds of discussion are going on, basically on what kind of agreements countries can reach in order to preserve the global environment, because global life support service can, you know, sort of become a threat to the entire world, not just to one country. Al Nino and several others are examples here. Global warming is a very important aspect here. Having said all this, I thought I will provoke all my colleagues who teach basic engineering in these colleges. So I am trying to connect now to what I said till now, to what is widely known to you, not to me. What is widely known to you? For most of you who teach this, once I say what concept it is, you will know, oh, this is what my cup of tea. Yes, of course, it's your cup of tea, which is what I have tried to learn from my students here. The first two laws of thermodynamics, which are taught to all the engineering students across the globe. So, the two important physical laws and the relevance for the way we view the interrelationships. So, the first two laws of thermodynamics hold true in strictly closed systems, that is systems with no external inputs. So, we have also talked about system with no external inputs, because in this circular flow, if you remember, I have not brought in trade. Imports and exports, in economic system we consider exports as, exports are outflow to the system, because they made here but consumed elsewhere. But we consider imports as inflow to the system, because they made elsewhere and brought in here. So sometimes the threat to environment can also come from consumption of imports, the toys from China, for example, they dumped here, low cost, all the mobile sets, plenty of them. Imports used, inflows, outflows. But we are not talking about that. So we are talking about closed system, consumption, production within an economy, within the geographical bound of an economy. We are not talking about that. There can be cross-border emissions, flow of pollution. There can be cross-border impacts, but that all we deal with in the global life support system, that is E4. So, since I am talking about a closed system, closed economy model as we call it, since I am talking about closed economy model, only two sectors, I am able to try and link it to the first two laws of thermodynamics, which also hold true in strictly closed systems. That is system with no external inputs. What happens there? The first law, as I understand, states that matter like energy can neither be created nor destroyed. Which by and large follows what is called the material balance principle. Why am I talking about it? I don't need to explain because you are all teaching this. Because of the implications. What are the implications? As more matter is extracted by the production process, more waste is generated, which must eventually be returned to the environment. Since the matter energy content of the extracted material cannot be destroyed, so it eats into your amenity. Because it comes to sink and therefore sink cannot, so it places limits on the degree to which resources can be substituted for each other in production. So it has to be dealt with. Following the first law of thermodynamics. Second is your entropy law, which says in a closed system, the use of matter energy causes a one-way flow entropy resources from entropy resources to high entropy resources from order to disorder. That is something that already very familiar to all of you. And for energy, the amount of work that energy can do is diminished. Well, of course, the only caveat here is we can talk about recycling. Therefore, I would not like to interpret the entropy law as a harbinger of doom. I am a positivist. Therefore, I say recycling can become. When it is useful to understand, while it is useful to understand, so it is important that we talk about recycling. That is why we talk about recycling. So, recycling takes place within consumption, within production, but that may have to increase. So, activity continues, activity grows, recycling also grows, and thereby there is a less pressure on the environment as well as on the global life support system. So, that is exactly how one can allow economic activity to continue. So, here I am not talking about growth, development or anything, just simple economic activity in terms of consumption and production, which have to go on as long as we are alive, as long as the human beings live on this earth or other living beings also live on this earth. So, this activities, this basically consumption production, how it sort of connects to environment and how environment also will have to definitely sort of react to what we expect to the growing needs of consumption and production, etc., and how we can minimize the adverse impact on the environment is what we need to learn and adopt. So, this is not to say that consumption production activity has to be curbed or reduced or on a slower phase, etc. Nobody will accept it, nor are we recommending that. But the first step therefore is to understand that economic activities, when they take place autonomously on their own, having such impacts on the environment in terms of the changing lifestyles, changing production process, changing consumption process, and depending on more and more on energy, creation of energy, and drawing more and more resources from the environment, and thereby understanding the, we should be able to manage this given the understand, if we are able to understand the first two laws of thermodynamics, because in a closed system that's exactly what happens. Now when you open up, it will open up several other opportunities, etc. So that we will discuss in subsequent. So I just wanted to give you a prelude to what is in store, and the first topic I'm talking to you is interaction between economic activity and the environment. So if they want to ask me some questions, or I think they're welcome to do that. And the one last slide I want to show is the I would like you to look up this references by Shogren and White. It's a first chapter of the book, The Economy and the Environment, Two Parts of a Whole. Okay, so thank you. Questions?
So I have one simple question for you, sir.
Please.
So in your slide there was, while it is useful to understand recycling, it is not necessarily the harbinger of doom. Couldn't understand the meaning, sir.
That is deliberately put to check whether you are awake. Okay, now what I am trying to say here, it is not, recycling is not harbinger of doom, but it is the entropy law is not the harbinger of doom. That is what I meant. That is the meaning of that.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, welcome.
Is Thermal College?
Hello, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, madam.
Nowadays, due to various activities, the coral reefs in sea destroyed. I read some from newspaper, private sectors took some actions to regenerate it. Is central government take steps for regenerating it? And I have one more question. Is the price of goods, materials like petroleum, diesel, determined by the environment?
Unfortunately, no. Because the prices are by and large fixed by the demand supply situation. But it is now, when you hear from me later on, what is called product charges, there they try to bring in the environment. So for instance, the taxes and levies that we pay for some of the commodities and services that we derive from environment are costs of extraction of these resources. Otherwise, especially in terms of environment, otherwise they are by and large reflecting only the production cost. Okay, now answering your first question, central government is now through the coastal zones regulation is also trying to see what they can do for coral reefs. Okay, so we will talk about it as we talk about, you know, climate change and coastal resources, etc.
College of Engineering, Bhuvaneshwar.
Hello, I am Mr. Pratik Kumar Shah from CB.
Oh, please go ahead.
Hello, my question is that, yes sir, listen, my question is that, now we are adopting globalization and liberation era. Can you define corporate social responsibility for protection of our environment from this point of view?
Well, that's a big challenge.
Corporate social responsibility.
Yeah, corporate social responsibility. We amended last year the act.
How it can be helpful for protection of our environment?
In one sentence, if we allow corporates to adopt sustainable business practices and put them under corporate social responsibility, they can participate in this. That's the only way. That is, allowing them to have sustainable business practices as a part of CSR.
My second question is that, we are sometimes saying that higher inflation is dangerous for the growth of an economy. Can you justify that? What way inflation and growth of an economy are correlated?
This question will require 45 minutes answer for me, but I will just quickly tell you that there are acceptable rates of inflation across all countries. So we have what is called inflation target. So anything above the target can really harm the economy, because that will lead to too much of money chasing too few goods. Okay. So therefore, it will only become more and more monetized and less of commodity being supplied to the system. Okay.
My third question is that, sir, how cost benefit analysis is helpful for projecting evaluation, particularly hydroelectricity point of view, hydroelectricity project point of view?
In fact, it is highly helpful in all the power plants, including hydroelectricity. It's a tool. We have to use it as a tool to understand the costs and benefits, identify the costs and benefits, and compare. If the benefits outweigh the cost, then only we should go in for the program, not otherwise. So it is highly useful in most environmental, especially most of the energy projects. and now become mandatory also.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Oh, welcome.
Walchan.
Hello. Question is, what is environmental audit and how it is done?
Okay. Environmental audit is just like, you know, auditors looking at basically our income and expenditure statements or the income expenditure statements of companies, etc. The way CAs, chartered accountants, look at the auditing. Now, environmental audit is also being done. It's a technique that have really come popular in the last two decades. Now, that has also become mandatory for several of the projects to be used, especially when you are going to use the resources of the environment for development or other related purposes. So, I will give you a, you know, sort of a picture of what exactly is done in environmental audit as we discuss. Okay, I just wanted to tell you that there is something called environmental audit that exists today.
Silicon Institute.
That is, I am Vicky Mishra. My question is on from environmental impact analysis.
Yes.
We know for construction of any project, it has both positive and negative impacts.
Correct.
For construction of any project, we are generally calculate the cost benefit ratio. But while calculating the cost benefit ratio for EIA, how we are calculating the cost benefit ratio for a project and how we can assess it? Another question that is relating to that one, that is, the what are the components actually we are consider for calculating this cost benefit ratio?
Again, EIA, my answer is similar to what I said, because EIA is a tool. Cost benefit is also a tool. So what are the various dimensions, how we are going to compare is what we are going to be talking here. So they are important tools where we will identify the costs, we identify the benefits. It's like a balance sheet we prepare of the benefits and costs and see if the benefits outweigh the costs, then we go ahead, otherwise we don't go ahead with that particular project. But here, when we do this, there are a number of concepts that we have to learn because we have to impute some values. We have to introduce what is called shadow prices for the environmental goods. So all that, which is also part of the contingent valuation, etc., we'll learn. Okay, so you have to wait. We'll be talking about cost benefits for most of the project, how exactly it is being done and how we make the comparisons and finally take a call.
Is there any criteria or it has some means it should be more than it is some, how we, it is assessed that it's okay?
No, it is assessed mostly in terms of listing and valuation of all the benefits and again estimation of costs that are involved in this particular project. For example, if you are dealing with a particular, you know, thermal power plant, we identify benefits, direct benefits, indirect benefits, okay, to private benefits as well as societal benefits. Again, cost to the plant, which you can easily measure, as well as cost to society, including the environmental costs. That's exactly how we sort of assess and compare.
Finalized by argument method or it is finalized by some logistic is there?
No, basically it is like a matrix, you know, you prepare a matrix of all this in terms of the benefits and costs listed and then say compare these two. So, in fact, earlier before this, mostly people have been using SWOT analysis, but now they started getting into because you can, in some sense, you try to bring in the material balance principle to estimate this. In terms of value, we do the comparisons. Comparisons are mostly done through the valuation.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Welcome. You're welcome.
IPS Academy.
What is the relationship between environmental and natural resources economics?
Okay. See, well, there are a lot of similarity between them, but environmental resources by and large deal with, I guess it also includes air and water pollution. Whereas when it comes to natural resources, we expect them to be produced, given by the, supported by the nature. So, we talk in terms of the forests, water bodies and the like. So, that, but of course, there's large overlap between these two. There are various disciplines, sub-disciplines that have come within environmental economics. So, therefore, some of them would like to call it economics of biodiversity, some of them would like to call it natural resource economics, some of them would like to talk about environmental economics and the like. So, there are various nomenclatures. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Okay.
Okay. So, have a wonderful evening and thank you for the opportunity to interact with you.